Did you hear that?
BuyRaycon.com/RFR. That's BuyRaycon.com/RFR. Get 15% off Raycon wireless earbuds. BuyRaycon.com/RFR. And we thank them so much for their support of us here at Rebel Force Radio.
Fun begins.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
This is Rebel Force Radio,
your source for the Force.
Star Wars news and commentary
with Jason Swank and Jimmy Mack.
I've seen Star Wars 500 times.
Star Wars number one.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe. I suggest we use it.
Now it's time for Rebel Force Radio.
We would be honored if you would join us.
You know, after the sequel trilogy wrapped, and whether you loved it or you didn't like it, there was a universal sense of, well, we never got that reunion. We never got the big reunion between the core cast. And I kept thinking to myself, well, we kind of did. I mean, there was a reunion. Because it was back in, I believe, 2000, what's the year on this? 2005, there was this Vanity Fair magazine right here. Vanity Fair magazine. It was the big Star Wars spectacular. It was right on the heels of the release of Revenge of the Sith. And they did this amazing, Andy Leibowitz did this amazing, huge pullout graphic of the prequel trilogy actors and the sequel trilogy actors, everybody from, of course, George Lucas, Hayden Christensen, Natalie Portman, Sam Jackson, Christopher Lee, rest his soul, is even in here. And then you get to the end and look at that, the original trilogy. You got Carrie Fisher loving on Harrison Ford. He sits there in his jeans and his button down. And there's Mark wearing that leather jacket we've talked about. I think that was Mark's uniform back in the early 2000s and the late 90s. Well, anyway, turns out that never happened. Never happened. It was all Photoshopped. Mark Hamill went on to Twitter and tweeted this. He said how great it was getting together with all those Star Wars folks after so many years. Not so fun fact. I was doing 8 shows a week on Broadway and couldn't be there. So Annie Leibovitz shot me all alone on that empty set and Photoshopped me into the group later. Now, my suspicion is that he wasn't the only one. But anyway, so even that illusion is ruined for me. So we'll see what other folks think about that and so much more. We've got a great show in store for you, including some details about a new Lego Star Wars special coming up. Maybe the very first Halloween special. Also, Giancarlo Esposito, who always spills the tea a little bit when he's out in public. He made a recent appearance at a convention and talked to a young convention goer. And we've got highlights from that. Plus, Felicity Jones promoting a film talks a little bit of Jyn Erso. And coming up later in the cantina, Mark Anthony Austin, Boba Fett from Star Wars A New Hope, the special edition. He also worked on the film, in addition to being on camera. So a great show. You're not going to want to miss a second of it. And of course, I can't do it alone. I have with me, as always, my good friend and yours from Chicago, Jimmy Mack.
Hey, Jason. Hey, Star Wars fans. Not photoshopped in this week. I'm actually here. Yeah. Okay, Jason didn't have to photograph me on some other set and then photoshop me into this show. No, I'm actually here. This is another Rebel Force Radio reunion you've all been waiting for. Me and Swank.
Every week.
I haven't seen him since Friday night when we did the Bad Batch after show. So thank God we've had this reunion has been a long time coming.
You remember seeing that Vanity Fair?
Oh, yeah.
Show? I mean, this was such a big deal. Yeah. I always looked forward to those Vanity Fairs, that would come out. And they continued that tradition through the sequel trilogy as well. But that pullout is so cool. And I guess it was very naive of me to think that they were all together. But I thought, hey, it's probably L.A. You know, why not? They might have all gotten together for something. Maybe George, you know, George has got plenty of dough. He's like, yeah, Annie, yeah, I'll send out my jet, pick them all up. But and the only thing that Mark was able to confirm was that he wasn't there. But I suspect that that's probably the case for most of them. Now, the picture of Carrie with Harrison there, she's getting familiar with Harrison. We know that they have quite a, you know, on again, off again romance in real life. You think that was legit? You think they photoshopped her right on top of him?
No,
she's hanging all over. There's wizards, you know, they got to get ILM to do this.
That's probably the only way they got Harrison in on the photo shoot to begin with. Only if you have Carrie hanging all over me, then I'll do it.
Tell him, tell Harrison we're gonna have Carrie there. She's still got a thing for him. But I
looked forward to all those Annie Leibovitz photo shoots, and I loved her work with Rolling Stone and all the pictures of the rock stars she's taken over the years. And these Star Wars actors, they are rock stars in our world, no doubt about it. So they deserve the rock star treatment from Annie Leibovitz.
That's a great analogy. They are rock stars. You're absolutely
they are rock stars. Hell yeah. Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher, Harrison Ford. Those guys are the original. The original rock trio, man. They, you know, as far as Star Wars goes, so they deserve the rock star treatment. I know I have that magazine somewhere in my archives, but I'm glad you had it right there within arm's reach.
I did. I have all my Vanity Fairs. I have a whole shelf of all my, I have a shelf of Star Wars Insider magazines and then a shelf of other magazines that feature Star Wars, and the Vanity Fair ones are a ton of fun. And then the Entertainment Weekly has done some great covers, you know, Star Wars covers over the years. Have those.
That's what I got to work on is shelves. That might be my second half of 2021 resolution. Get this stuff out of the bins and onto shelves.
And onto shelves, I guess.
So I can just reference it at a moment's notice.
Hey, as we were talking about Mark Hamill, I got to say, and we're not a collecting, everyone knows we're not a dedicated collecting podcast, but
everyone, we are dedicated collectors.
That's right.
Ironically.
Yes. But this, I saw this over the weekend, this incredible sideshow Luke, but it's not just any Luke. It's Jedi Luke, or Luke in his Jedi robes. And the black, you know, outfit that we're used to seeing him in Return of the Jedi, but it's from The Mandalorian. And what's amazing to me about this, I mean, Sideshow does incredible work. The sculpts are incredible. But what I thought was so interesting is last week we were talking about how Lucasfilm had hired the deepfake guy, the YouTube deepfake guy, because he was able to do what a lot of people think a better job than what ILM did with their adding, you know, Mark Hamill circa 1983, 80, I guess, plus maybe aged up a few years into The Mandalorian. But this sculpt that they're doing on this sideshow is not an idealized version like what the deepfake guy did. This is a true representation of what the effects looked like when you watched the show. And that really jumped out at me that, you know, Sideshow, these manufacturers, they could go a lot of different ways. They could have just, if they really they wanted to go the Hasbro route, they could have just repackaged the same exact Luke Skywalker, you know, Jedi figure and thrown a baby Yoda in there with him. And, you know, they'd have a new, thing to sell, but they didn't do that. They did this extremely detailed version, but it really does make me notice, and not in a bad way, but the differences between Mark Hamill circa Return of the Jedi and this image that we got in The Mandalorian. Very cool looking.
I mean, it's good that they're staying accurate to the source material. I prefer that as opposed to, like, you know, Luke with the feathered hair from Tatooine. You know, this is a more groomed, more disciplined Luke Skywalker. But notice the differences in the wardrobe a little bit, especially with that belt that he's wearing. Luke didn't wear that type of belt with his Jedi robes in A New Hope. He wore them more with that the black combat fatigues he wore on Endor. But at the beginning of the film, when he went to Jabba's palace, he was wearing black Jedi robes specifically. Luke is not wearing Jedi robes when he has the showdown with Vader aboard the Death Star 2.
Correct.
He's not wearing Jedi robes. He's just dressed in black.
Yep.
And you notice with these robes, there's the same belt he was wearing at the end of Return of the Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
But he has the Jedi robes on that he was wearing at the beginning of the film.
Right.
So I just think that's kind of a neat little variation on the costume design. It's kind of an amalgam of both costumes that he wore in Return of the Jedi.
You're absolutely right. The differences are very subtle, much like the differences in the Vader costume from film to film. They're there, but they're very subtle. The one thing that I think is true is in The Mandalorian, his cloak, his outer cloak, the hooded cloak, is black, whereas in Return of the Jedi, it was a dark brown, like a real dark brown.
Did you see that piece of artwork Russell Walks created featuring Luke with Baby Yoda? Luke has a yellow lightsaber crystal hovering in his palm, and Baby Yoda is playing around with the pieces of a lightsaber, you know, trying to forge them all together to create a single hilt for the crystal. And it's just a brilliant piece. It was a San Diego Comic-Con exclusive print. San Diego Comic-Con was all virtual this year. But the print went on sale over the weekend. There it is. You found it.
We got it right here. Yeah.
And Baby Yoda. So, yeah, Russell created this. And look at Luke. He's wearing interesting Jedi robes. He has the black undershirt, but he definitely has more of a sandy-colored brown cloak.
Yes.
Different from Obi-Wan and the other Jedi, maybe more closely, it looks more closely in appearance to Yoda's cloak a little bit.
Yeah, definitely does. Mm-hmm. I love this. I did not see this. This is really cool. So this was a poster that was available, like a print?
Yeah, a print. And people ordered it online and they started showing up at people's houses. And there was some complaints about them being too pixelated. So I know, Barry from the Babu Freaks was not happy about that. And he mentioned something to the manufacturer. I think they're going to make good on it. But
when I look at this, not to be too nitpicky, I mean, it's a great image, but I look at this and I go, oh, that's Empire era Luke face.
Yeah, right. Even the hair and everything.
Yep. Yeah.
So he's not really sticking to the Mandalorian look.
No.
With the really, because I mean, on The Mandalorian, it looked like Luke's hair was carved out of wood. It was just so, it just was attached to his head so tightly. Look at that.
Yeah.
I mean, granted, we're just looking at an action figure, but
sure,
it does resemble the hairstyle Luke had in The Mandalorian. And then when you compare it to Russell's image, yeah, that's definitely more of a episode 5 Shaggy Do. You know, he still has some of that Tatooine freak kind of on display.
I was going to say Tatooine sand, but hey, that works too. That works too.
Tatooine funk. Yeah.
Anyway, well, that's very cool. And it did make me think too, you know, and we've talked about this quite a bit, is if Sideshow Collectibles, and we know that there's a long lead time for getting a toy to market. There's sculpting, there's, you know, all the R&D and all of that. But, you know, I'm seeing Sideshow beat out some of the other manufacturers, you know, namely Hasbro, of getting this stuff out to market. Like, I just don't know why we have to wait years to get a Luke Skywalker as he looked in The Mandalorian action figure. I mean, Star Wars practically, it didn't invent the action figure, but it certainly reinvented the action figure. And so I feel like it should really lead the way on this stuff, as long as they're going to have the license. And I got to tell you, I really, really strongly believe this. I think that when I look at what Hasbro is doing with the Star Wars license, I think they're just squatting on it.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of other companies, because what we're hearing is, well, the kids aren't buying. It's not a play pattern for kids anymore. Kids aren't buying Star Wars toys. Fine. Great. You're too big of a company. You cannot you cannot, you're not scaled right to serve the collector market, which you claim is now all that's interested in Star Wars. So give up the license.
Give it up. Cough it up, fuzzball. Yeah, I don't like the way Hasbro's doing things. They're clearly operating on the cheapest budget possible for creating Star Wars toys, and Star Wars deserves much better. But
they deserve
cut
the best.
Corners left and right. It really does. But Hasbro's just cut the corners left and right with the brand, leaving collecting at least 3¾-inch. You know, that's like a dead hobby now in their hands. Right. Fans are doing it so much better. Mm-hmm. I am purchasing action figures made by fans left and right. Whereas Hasbro, I would love to purchase things from you guys, but you're not creating anything worth purchasing. And the things you do create worth purchasing are never available to the regular consumer for more than like 15 minutes. You got it right, Jason. It's too big of a corporation. They just don't care about anything but the bottom line, operating on the cheap and just really disregarding 4.5 decades worth of collecting legacy. And, you know, I've given up hope on them doing the right thing ever. The brand has got to change hands and move over to a different licensee. Hasbro, you had me, but you lost me.
Yeah, and the tools and the resources that fans have nowadays, you know, just they're literally making their own action figures from scratch, the 3D printing and all
Hasbro
of that.
Needs to step it up. We're going to be able to produce our own action figures at home within the decade. And it's going to happen, and fans are going to be making patterns available to other fans, and we'll be passing those around, and we'll be passing by your store displays in the big box stores and not dropping a dime on your product because you failed us. You failed us.
That is why you fail.
let's go to news.
Yoda.
I have good news for you, my lord.
That's good news.
Come closer, I have good news.
Hey, you've heard of the Star Wars Holiday Special, right? There were two of them, actually. There was the original in 1978, and then there was one last year during the holiday season, 2020. It was the Lego Holiday Special. It's the one that they admit to. It's the child that they will claim of the holiday specials. But there was an announcement this week that the gang is coming back. I believe this is all the same folks that brought you the Lego Holiday Special last year are coming back with a Halloween special. I love this. I think this is going to be cool. I know I might be a little bit bigger of a fan of the Lego stuff than you are, Jim. I know you're kind of hit or miss on it. But this is going to be called Terrifying Tales. It's going to premiere on October 1st, of course, on Disney Plus. And as the last holiday special was exclusive for Disney Plus, so will this be. But in time for Halloween, and the image, for those of you listening to the podcast, is pretty cool. So you have a graveyard with a big tombstone, and the Imperial cog is on the tombstone, and it says, "Rest in Pieces."
Nice.
And then there is a Lego hand coming up through the ground with a red lightsaber. And presumably this is the grave of Darth Vader, I would assume. I guess.
Lego Darth Vader.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Like he didn't meet the funeral pyre in the Lego Star Wars. No.
Luke would have had different lightsabers. Like, this could have been Luke's hand, but... no, the Imperial cog and the red lightsaber is a dead giveaway. It's got to be him. Although, it's got to be him. We're going to say it's Vader. So the voice cast, Jake Green, you know, come back as Poe Dameron. And I guess the plot is, according to the official announcement, that after the events of The Rise of Skywalker, Poe Dameron and BB-8 must make an emergency landing on the volcanic planet Mustafar, where they meet the greedy and conniving Grabala the Hutt. Grabala. The crime boss has purchased Darth Vader's castle and is renovating it into the galaxy's first all-inclusive Sith-inspired luxury hotel.
Of course. That's exactly the direction I thought this was going in. Sith Hotel. Is that like the Motel Hell? You remember that movie from 1981?
Yeah, when they were all buried up to their neck.
You check in, but you don't check out.
She would like, she'd have to like water and feed the bodies that were all buried into the, oh my God. I had that move. That was one of those movies. See, as kids in the, that grew up in the 70s and 80s, these movies would show up on TV late at night. And even though they would be edited all to heck and back, you know, you're 9 years old, you're flipping around, you're staying up late, parents have gone to bed, and you're like, ooh, I'm going to watch something. And you stumble on that. And I don't know what happens at that age. You're horrified and fascinated at the same time. You can't stop watching, but you're scaring the living you-know-what out of yourself. That was me in Motel Hell.
You know, being afraid is fun. You know, getting scared is fun. And when you get to a certain age, you start to recognize that. You don't become overcome with fear.
Right, right, right.
You actually are like, hey, wait a second. This is generating a wild response from me. Let's keep going.
Right. I like it.
I kind of like it.
Yeah. So anyway, so yeah, so the Darth Vader's castle's turned into a Sith-inspired luxury hotel. While waiting for his X-Wing to be repaired, Poe, BB-8, Grabala, and Dean, a plucky and courageous young boy who works at Grabala's as Grabala's mechanic, they venture deep into the mysterious castle with Vader's loyal servant, Vinay. Now, is that the guy? Yeah, that's the guy from Rogue One, right?
Yes. Yes.
Vinay, with an accent mark. So along the way, Vinay shares three creepy stories linked to ancient artifacts and iconic villains from across all eras of Star Wars. As Vinay spins his tales and lures our heroes deeper into the shadowy underbelly of the castle, a sinister plan emerges. With the help of Dean, Poe, and BB-8, we'll have to face their fears, stop an ancient evil from rising, and escape to make it back to their friends. So that's it. That's the plot. It'll be fun.
Sounds good. It'll be fun. That's what I'm looking for, is fun from this. And I love the poster with the lightsaber hand reaching out of the grave. I just think it looks great. And it looks like something fun. So that's going to be dropping on October 1st. October 1st, by the way, is a Friday. Remember, we had heard that new content was going to drop on Disney Plus on Wednesdays due to the success of Loki. But here we are with an original special streaming October 1st, Friday. So maybe they just wanted to get it in by the beginning of October and just targeted that date. Or maybe it's only for series that, you know, live action series are going to drop on Wednesdays. I'm not 100% sure.
Well, you know what? I wonder if it has to do with that first of the month and people maybe that are month to month on their Disney Plus subscription. They want to get content loaded in the first of the month so people renew. They don't cancel that smart subscription. So
that's smart thinking. This is the same crew that has done things like the Lego Holiday Special and Freemaker Adventures. Ken Cunningham, the director, was the director of the Holiday Special, and the voices, Dana Snyder as Grabala the Hutt. He's back in that role from Freemaker Adventures, Jason.
Adventures. Grabala was a character from Freemaker?
Yes.
Oh, gotcha. Yes. Okay. I didn't watch that. I didn't watch Freemaker really at all.
Yeah, I've caught glimpses of it here and there. You know, it's really silly and goofy, but it's kind of fun. Tony Hale is going to play Vani, and Vader's consort from the Rogue One.
Yeah,
or his manservant, his creepy manservant. You know.
Yeah.
Reminded me a lot of Lurch from the Addams Family. It kind of served a similar role, too. Right. He's like Vader's Lurch.
Yeah.
But Tony Hale is playing that character. Tony played Buster on Arrested Development. He was Buster.
I love that guy. Yeah, he's great.
And then, oddly enough, Christian Slater is in this show. I didn't even know he was doing voice work now.
Know that either.
He's playing Ren. Whoever Ren is.
Kylo? Ren?
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. And but the only real veteran of Star Wars animation outside of Lego that I recognize is Mary Elizabeth McGlynn. And she's going to play NIL-8, which may be a character she's played before in other Lego shows like Freemaker, what have you. But she was also the voice of... She was the voice of somebody in Rebels. I think she was the Imperial officer that was stationed on Lothal. I think that's who she played. I can't remember the name of that character either. She was big in season two.
Yeah. The one that was on the train on the bus when R2 and 3PO showed up, wasn't that? Didn't they show up in an episode?
Yeah, but that was like very early in season one. I don't know if that's the same season. Was R2 and 3PO even in the show beyond that season one?
I don't think so. No, I think that was one.
Pardon me, ladies and gentlemen. I just don't know Rebels like the back of my hand like I do other Star Wars. So I get tripped up on it from time to time. That's why I put it on in my studio just in the background while I'm doing work, because I think maybe I'll absorb this stuff a little bit better and I won't have these moments on RFR, total brain fart moments.
But it happens. We can't know everything. It's a big galaxy. That's why we have all these
listeners. Coming up on 15 years of podcasting. Gosh. And next month, 15 years.
I was just talking, if you haven't listened to the live after shows that we do for Bad Batch, this past week we had a listener call and say that he'd been listening to us since he was 12 years old.
Yeah.
And he's 27 now.
Yeah.
Which was crazy. He's like, you got me through. Yeah. Middle school, high school, college.
Two marriages.
Yeah. So we've been doing this a long time. My son still really enjoys the Star Wars Lego stuff. We laughed our heads off with the holiday special, and I love, you know, it's a kind of an underrated thing. You don't get a lot of Halloween specials. I mean, you got to really be a sort of a veteran property and have that a couple of other holiday specials out before you get the Halloween special. So that's kind of fun. And Star Wars, you know, outside of those novels with the zombie troopers that came out several years ago, Star Wars
Death
is never
troopers.
The Death Troopers. Where's that action figure? I would love that Death Trooper action figure. It'd be a lot of fun.
My friend Bo Glazer, who's sadly no longer with us, he made me an action figure of a Death Trooper carded action figure. It's awesome custom.
Oh, how cool.
I should post a picture of it somewhere.
It's very cool. But Star Wars hasn't really embraced, you know, the Halloween thing. So this will be fun. October 1st. Speaking of fun, I thought this was a convention, this Giancarlo Esposito clips that we have. Yeah, okay. And, the clip comes from WRAL-TV. So this was GalaxyCon in Raleigh, North Carolina. And was the little kid playing like correspondent? Was he like a guest correspondent?
I think he was the reporter's kid. They refer to the kid online as our youth correspondent. But don't worry about him. You're not going to hear him in any of these clips, really.
Well, he's a cute
kid. Is irrelevant.
But what's relevant is that it's Giancarlo Esposito, who is, you know, characteristically, or he's always very enthusiastic about his work and his life, and especially when it comes to Mandalorian. So, Jim, I know you pulled some clips from this for us, because there are a few little nuggets in here that we might be able to extract.
For sure. We'll start off with the first thing he says. It's just a casual conversation with the reporter and the kid. They hand him a Baby Yoda toy, like a plushie. And he's playing around with it, and he starts rapping about Baby Yoda. He starts dropping information about Baby Yoda, and he's kind of off mic here, so it's a little hard to tell. Throughout this entire interview, they don't have Giancarlo mic'd for crap, but you'll hear him talk about Baby Yoda, and he might be revealing some implications and impact the little guy might have on season 3.
This child has magic powers, 50 years old, and can see the future. And we want everyone to know, eventually on this show, that this child could save our universe.
So what he said, what I heard was, this child has special powers.
Yes.
That was one thing. And he said, on our show, what we want everybody to know is that he... What was the last bit? He can heal the universe, save the universe.
Yes.
Save the universe.
That's what he said.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, I don't know if he's speaking like in hyperbole, you know, or just like filling in details about Baby Yoda he assumes is consistent with all Force users, like seeing the future. I mean, Baby Yoda has given us no indication that he can see the future. Right. But it seems like that's a fairly common thing with Jedi, where they can sense things before they happen.
Right.
As Qui-Gon Jinn said.
See things.
See things before they happen.
Right.
But you don't really know if... Giancarlo is speaking in terms of solid reality or just kind of this idealized version of Baby Yoda he might be thinking.
Now, if Jimmy Mack and I were there, I'd be like, specifically?
Yeah, right.
In generality? What?
Whoa, whoa, Esposito, rewind. Rewind. Back it up.
Yeah.
Back it up, Esposito. Beep, beep. Beep. Back it up.
Because we're not a cute kid, he'd hightail it out of there as soon as we started grilling him for a follow-up.
Well, as I listen to this interview, I mean, I can tell he's being very deliberately careful about things he says.
Yeah.
Now, the stuff he says about Baby Yoda, it appears to have been happening before the interview proper actually begins. So, thus, he's way off mic. He's just meeting these people. They hand him the plushy Baby Yoda, and he just starts talking. You know, he sees a kid, and he's talking in very hushed tones. He turns it on a little more once the interview starts going. The next question they have for him is, will we see him in season 3? And keep in mind, he's holding the plushy Baby Yoda when they ask him this question.
Yes, you're going to see me kill this baby. How about that?
That's wrong.
It's totally wrong.
I love it. He's got the kid there.
Did you hear, like, the,
he's holding the kids. It's not just any Baby Yoda. It's the kid's own personal. Plus, he probably sleeps with it. And Esposito's just holding it by the ears.
Yeah. Well, I think he's holding by the neck at this point, like squeezing.
Yeah,
the little kid's eyeballs are bulging out of his head.
You're going to see me kill him. That's what you're going to see.
Play that again and listen for the psychotic laugh after he says he's going to kill the baby.
You're going to see me kill this baby. How about that?
How about
it's
that?
It's totally wrong.
How about that?
That's funny.
What do you think of that, kid?
Well, like I said, people have fun being scared.
All right.
I probably scared the pants off of that kid.
Oh, man.
But, so he's just kidding around. But they get into some serious question and answer with him, and they ask him if season 3 will start shooting this year. Now, I think I reported here on RFR last week that I believed season 3 had already begun shooting.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it has. You know, I just don't think Giancarlo's been called onto the set quite yet. But they ask him, will season 3 start shooting this year? And listen to the way he answers the question, and then I will analyze the way he answers the question.
All right.
Yes, they just finished information. They just finished shooting Boba Fett, and soon they will start on season 3 of Mandalorian.
Okay. So he's telling us what we know. They just finished shooting on Boba Fett, which was like a month ago when they wrapped that up. Because you had Tem in the hot tub in New Zealand, you know. That seals the deal.
Yeah.
That shooting is completed. Oh, New Zealand. Oh, my bones are aching. Okay. But I love that video of Tem, too.
It's great.
Boba Fett in a hot tub. But let's play this again, because Giancarlo slips up at the very beginning. He doesn't say they finished shooting Boba Fett. He says we, and then he corrects himself real fast. Listen.
Yes, they just finished information. They just finished shooting Boba Fett, and soon they will start on season 3 of Mandalorian.
Oh, yeah, and then he goes, information.
Yeah, information. Keep what can I say?
What can I say?
Right. That's what he was doing.
Yeah.
He was trying to think, what can I say? Because he goes, they just finished shooting. He corrects himself so super fast, but not that fast, not so fast that I can't pick up on his slip up.
Yeah.
I think we're going to see Moff Gideon in the Book of Boba Fett.
I was just going to say.
I predict it right now.
I think you're right. And something we haven't really talked about is will the Book of Boba Fett lead right into season 3 of The Mandalorian? I predict it will. I think you're right. Yes. And we'll see Moff Gideon as part of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So, Giancarlo slipping up a little bit there. Thought you could get away with it. You had a little kid in front of you, huh? Trying to throw him off the scent by threatening to kill Baby Yoda. No, we're on top of you, Giancarlo. We're studying everything you have. We are Zapruder filming you, my man.
So back Giancarlo, and to the left. Back and to the left.
Oh, God. And so in our final clip, Giancarlo is asked if Pedro Pascal's busy schedule, if that's going to slow down production at all, because I think Pedro's shooting some Netflix show right now or something. I don't know the name of it, but from what I understand, he's been pretty busy with that, you know, since late spring, early summer. So let's hear what Giancarlo Esposito has to say about Pedro Pascal's busy schedule.
I don't know what Pedro's up to. We never have to wait on Pedro because
that's what I was wondering. He's going to be more off the helmet.
You know, I can't speak to that. I mean, I know he'd love to be more off the helmet, but you know, his job is to be in the helmet. You know, I mean, that's the deal. Yeah. But I'm sure that he has worked out something to do his other show and come back and do us.
I love Giancarlo Esposito.
He's great.
I love him in interviews. He's so real.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell the guy is like an actor's actor. He's one of those old school actors where it's his craft, it's his trade. And he talks about it. He doesn't talk about it in those terms like a lot of actors do, like it's some sort of magic trick. And I love that he's just like, Pedro, we don't wait on Pedro. I don't know what he's doing. I don't know what that guy's up to. He'd like to be in the helmet, but let's face it, his job is to be in the helmets. I don't know. I think it does lend Jim a little bit of credence. And you know, there were a lot of rumors that at the end of season 2 that there was some sort of falling out, and they got a lot of the rumors got kind of, I think, blown out of proportion. He stormed off set. He was fired, whatever. But I do think that there is there's enough smoke to indicate that Pedro is less than satisfied with the limited FaceTime he gets in the role. And that it seems like it's not lost on his fellow actors. And I think Giancarlo might be alluding to it a bit here.
For sure. For sure. I think that's the first real confirmation we heard those rumors about Pedro Pascal and that dang helmet that they make him wear.
Yeah.
Because really, Pedro struggles with that helmet so much. Any scenes where the Mandalorian isn't standing still or sitting down, you're almost guaranteed it's not Pedro Pascal in that armor. And he's
You can tell.
I can tell.
You can tell when it's Pedro.
I can tell when
it's Pedro. What are the tells? What do we look for?
Now, like, Pedro's not like a big stocky guy or anything, but I think that his stunt doubles are really slim, trim guys. And when Pedro was wearing that costume, I just noticed a little more substance under the armor plates.
Okay.
I just there's just something about the way he sort of fits into that armor that makes me identify when it's Pedro. It happened a couple of times during season 2. I can't always
tell,
but I really
it's
really
not as obvious
that,
as like you when you see those promo shots of Vader and you know it's Hayden Christensen Vader.
Right. You can always tell it's Hayden. And you know how you can always tell when it's Hayden? At least this is the case with the Revenge of the Sith era Vader armor, is the shoulder pads extend out beyond his arm. So you can see where, on David Prowse, it fits flush against his arm.
Right.
The shoulder pads come flush down. But with Hayden, you see it kind of sticks out a little bit on the sides. Mm. Look at pictures, Revenge of the Sith promo pics, and you'll see what I'm talking about. Plus, it doesn't seem like the garment that he wears under the armor really fits him as tightly as it did David Prowse. And I think the reason they extended those shoulder pads was to fill out the frame more. so it didn't look like a slim Vader, especially in that final scene when they're standing on the Star Destroyer.
Yeah, and I mean,
it comes in from the back. You have to have a big, broad-shouldered Vader standing there.
I mean, to give Hayden a little bit of, I mean, the guy, I mean, if you look at him in Revenge of the Sith, there's some, you know, he does have some kind of topless, shirtless, I guess, moment. And he did bulk up, but, but Dave Prowse, I mean, he's Dave Prowse. And I mean, this is a guy that could have been Conan the Barbarian. I mean, we're
Olympian.
Talking,
right. Mean, he was, and he was competing in all those Mr. Universe competitions with Schwarzenegger and stuff.
Lou Ferrigno. I mean,
he was a big dude and, like world-class big dude when he played Darth Vader. And Hayden he's an athlete. He's like a all world tennis player. He could have gone pro when he was younger if he didn't become an actor. But he definitely is in great shape and he looks great, but he's just really slim compared to Darth Vader.
Right.
So they needed a little bulking up in the suit for him to be convincing.
He looks bigger than me if I was in the Darth Vader costume, but
no, we're definitely going to see more Hayden as Vader.
Yeah.
So let's see how that goes. I mean, maybe they'll get a Vader, armor that fits him a little bit better around the arms. Maybe he won't need all that optical enhancement going on with extended shoulder pads and stuff. We'll see.
Who knows?
We'll see. I'm looking so forward to seeing him as Vader, by the way, too.
Well, great stuff. And hopefully as things get more real in the convention circuit, Giancarlo Esposito is one of those that I'm really anxious to hear more from. And I'd love to see him in person at a panel. And he's definitely, I think, one of those to watch as far as a guy who I think is really going to embrace the fans. And they're going to embrace him right back. Just a nice guy, fun guy, real guy. Have a quick clip right here of Felicity Jones. I mean, nothing crazy revealing, but when I heard it, I thought, you know what? I never really thought of that. Is that possible? So she's making the rounds promoting The Last Letter for Your Lover, which I can say definitively, I won't see. I can just tell you the name of that. No offense, but
your Jyn Erso fandom won't bring you the box office to see The Last Letter of Love or whatever that
but
is.
But when I watched the clip, I'm just reminded, she's so pretty. She's so cute. And it does remind me how much I really enjoy Rogue One. I mean, I just love it. But anyway, so here's a clip of her. And the question, and this comes from the Hey You Guys YouTube channel, I think that's a Goonies reference, actually, is there a future for Jyn Erso given the fact that we've got a Cassian Andor series coming out? What do you think? Is there a future? And this is what she has to say.
I know. Well, I was having this conversation with someone the other day, and I was trying to say, well, look, it's a bit of a sort of nuclear fallout at the end of the film. And they were like, no, it didn't feel like that. It doesn't feel like they die. And I was like, well, there you go.
So it doesn't feel like they die.
Well, someone says it doesn't feel like they die. So I thought, is there a world where they don't? Is there a world where they escape, they get off?
Wow. It seems so definitive. It seems so definite.
Right.
At the end of the film that they were swallowed up in that big blast created by the Death Star. That it just, the shockwave of that blast just engulfed them.
Right.
How could they have escaped that? They were in an embrace on their knees on the shoreline. Unless,
it's not Star Trek. They couldn't have been beamed up.
And who would have saved them? Everyone else was dead.
He dead?
They were all dead. Yes. That's right. All dead. All of them dead. I'll never forget that guy when he said that at that Star Wars celebration.
Oh,
he said was, what was his name? Zhang Wang or something?
Oh.
And very famous.
Baze Malbus was the character.
Yes. But he pointed over at... I think it was
Donnie Chen.
Donnie Yen.
Donnie Yen, yeah.
When this guy dead, I do something better.
What? Whoa. Rewind.
When this guy dead.
Meanwhile, there's all these Lucasfilm executives like sitting out in the crowd watching this, just going, oh, Jesus. What do we got to do, man? What do we got to do, you know? Who's in charge of the translations for him?
My English is very limited.
And it's not easy. There's that language barrier, and Lucasfilm right. is really, really tight on leaks and things like that, like more so than anywhere else, it seems like.
Mm-hmm.
And for a Chinese actor to stumble into that stuff, and, right. you know, he's just trying to put a sentence together on stage right. in front of several thousand people. I
no
can't
pressure.
Blame him for that. Yeah, right, right. He speaks far more English than I speak Chinese, that's for sure. So, you know, hats off to that guy. And I loved him in the film, too. But, man, what a spoiler he dropped. Then you just knew that everyone was dead.
Yes. And mm-hmm. that was sort of the recipe from the beginning was we got to write this movie and we got to kill off all our heroes. I mean, and that's what made writing it, I think, such a challenge, and one of the reasons why Gilroy had to step in, Tony Gilroy, and kind of right the ship. I believe the ending was changed. There was a there. I think one ending had them, Jim, if I'm right, all on a ship, and then the ship gets destroyed.
Yes, yes, yeah. I mean, nobody had that individual hero's moment,
right.
dying on the battlefield, you know. Like
in this way, they all get sort of a moment.
Even the droid.
Right.
Even the droid. And so they shot that several different ways. But mm-hmm. the one that stuck was obviously the one we saw. And it was clearly the most effective.
Yeah.
But you got to keep in mind, this is science fiction fantasy. So who really dies? You know, nobody
right.
does.
Right.
Nobody does. It's just like what Luke told Leia in The Last Jedi. Nobody's ever really gone, especially in filmmaking, franchise filmmaking. We got to bring him back. It's a big box office. So, and fans wanted to. Fans loved Rogue One so much. Mm-hmm. I don't care what they, you know, come up with to satisfy the fans of that. Obviously, the Andor show is coming, and that will scratch an itch for a lot of people who love Rogue One. But having that crew together for another adventure, I think, is pretty much impossible at this point.
It would be tough. Really... Unless they do one of those what-if things like they're doing for Marvel. They got a whole animated series of what-ifs, which, I mean, that's nothing new. I mean, comic books have been doing that for a long time. I mean,
yeah,
even but long.
It's just the thing is, if you do a what-if Star Wars and it turns out to be super successful, then you have a sub-franchise of, because everyone loves it, they want more. You have to do what if Rogue One over, you know, so many times. It becomes mm-hmm. a sub-franchise. When does it ever end? So just, you know, I like the Rogue One story. I'd like to see its integrity remain intact. And so I don't want to see Jen Erso come back in any story that fudges her death on mm-hmm. Scarif.
Yeah.
Now, if they wanted to put together a prequel, that could be interesting.
Well, I was going
to
ask you, I mean, Jyn Erso, I would imagine, led a pretty interesting life.
Yeah.
Particularly with how much of a centerpiece Saw Gerrera is becoming. It's unfolding. He's right there, kind of in the thick of things throughout the building of the rebellion and up until we see him. So, And he's essentially her godfather, her caretaker, her guardian for a number of years.
In his crew for a while.
Right. So
you could have like the Adventures of Saw and have Jyn Erso in that with that game.
Oh, I'd love to see that. And those guys and all those characters, I think that'd be fun.
And have them carrying out like effective raids against Imperial outposts and things like that. I mean, it doesn't have to be a big story about a planet destroying weapon.
Right.
And the Emperor and Darth Vader, you can make it small and just have them taking on some Imperial outpost. And the whole movie could be about them raiding the outpost and all that. It could be really fun.
Yeah. I mean, you've got a big mystery in this era that, you know, that needs solving. I mean, you've got the whole notion of the Emperor what he's trying to accomplish in terms of everlasting life. You've got the remnants of the clones and cloning, and it's such a big plot. You know, we're seeing it on some of it in The Mandalorian. We're seeing some of it in The Bad Batch. We're seeing, because it obviously follows Palpatine from when he got into power all the way through when you see him in Revenge of the Rise of Skywalker. So it's a big mystery, and you could potentially unfold different parts of it out throughout these series.
You know? It's necessary at this point. It's really necessary for them to flesh out what happens in 7, 8, 9, give us the setup, because it seems like that's more interesting than those actual movies that they made. You know, the whole, how did everyone get in the place? I would have liked to have seen the relationship between Luke Skywalker and Kylo Ren completely disintegrate, and, you know, not just see it in these 10-second flashbacks. Right. To me, that was the most interesting stuff.
Well, that was where most of the drama was.
Yeah.
At least,
and then everything else was just like, well, it's like this just because. Yeah. And just because doesn't fly with me as someone who's consuming a story. So,
right.
Definitely a lot of opportunity to fill in the blanks and add much more substance to the sequel trilogy than they currently have. I think The Mandalorian is on the road to doing that, but we still haven't seen any direct connections yet. But I think in season 3, we might.
Hey, before we head off into the cantina with our special guest, I do want to take a moment and thank our friends at Raycon. I don't know about you, but I'm certainly spending a lot more time on the commute. And one of the things that I like to do on my commute is catch up on phone calls. I'm not a big phone call guy, but I do like to, I call my mom sometimes on my drive home. I even used to do a podcast with Jimmy Mack on the drive home. And I did a lot of that with earbuds. And so no matter what you're feeling about getting back out there, there's no denying that it's an adjustment for all of us. And when the world gets too loud, something I like to do is create my own soundtrack by popping in my Raycon wireless earbuds. And sometimes you just need some upbeat music to pump you up before you get back out there in the real world to see people. You got to stay calm with some guided meditation. That can be done with your Raycons. Let me tell you right now, Raycons are the best way to listen. They come with a bunch of gel tips for your comfort. And unlike some other brands, they don't stick out of your ears. You don't look like you got straws poking out. Raycons have a 32-hour battery life, so you can listen to what you want, when you want, for a really long time. And they start at half the price of the other premium audio brands, but they sound just as good. And Raycons come with a 45-day happiness guarantee. So you really can't lose. Give them a try. You'll see what we mean. Create your own soundtrack with Raycon. Right now, Rebel Force Radio listeners can get 15% off their Raycon order at buyraycon.com/RFR. That's buyraycon, RAYCON.com/RFR to save 15% on Raycons. buyraycon.com/RFR. Okay, as we mentioned at the top of the show, we're going to go right into the cantina with a very special guest. Someone brand new to the show, Mark Anthony Austin, Boba Fett from Star Wars Episode 4, New Hope, the special edition. Star Wars
cantina. Where are you going, Austin?
For a drink.
Sorry about the mess.
You will never find a more wretched hive of scum and villainy. We must be cautious.
All right, Mark Anthony.
Hey, Mark.
Welcome to Rebel Force Radio.
It's good to be here.
Well, it's good to have you here. You're somebody I've been wanting to talk to for a little while. Uh-oh. Because I'm a huge Boba Fett fan.
Okay, that's
and,
what I mean.
Yeah, yes. And Daniel Logan has dropped your name a few times in conversation with me. So I thought I should shake you down.
Okay.
Being one of the few guys to actually play Boba Fett. Now, let me see if I got this right. How many people have played Boba Fett? Of course, you have Jeremy Bullock, Daniel Logan, Tem Morrison. Dickie Beard did the stunts. Don Bees, I believe, played Fett in the Return of the Jedi Special Edition. And you, sir, played Boba Fett in the New Hope Special Edition. Am I leaving anyone out? A stunt guy, maybe?
Stuntmen, yeah. There's several stuntmen.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah.
But I'd love to have an opportunity to
And the new guys from The Mandalorian. There's like maybe four or five new Boba Fett, so it's getting crowded in here.
There's a lot of Bobas in the house.
There
it's
is.
It's a Boba Fest, if you
will. It's a Boba Fest. Yes. Boba Fest.
But it's great to have you on the show, and I want to talk all things Boba Fett with you. But just really how you got into the special edition, for people who don't know your story, it's pretty cool because you're a diehard Star Wars fan, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, look at the shirt. Got the
He's
Boba,
got the Boba Fett
fan club.
There we
Boba
go.
Fett Boba Fett fan club. There you go. The Boba Fett fan club. You're a member of the Boba Fett fan club. Of course you are.
You've got all kinds of memorabilia behind you. You've got a Rancor. Looks like a maquette or a statue of some sort. You got a Stormtrooper helmet. And also seeing what looks like to be a poster-sized Topps trading card. I think it features Sand Trooper on a dewback. Look at that. That's cool.
Is that a piece of artwork or is that?
That's my painting, yeah.
Oh, you did that.
I did that, yeah.
Wow. Well,
that's fabulous.
And then we see.
And the probe droid and Leia. And look at this.
Wow. We had no idea that you were also.
No.
A traditional artist in the sense. Well, we knew you were a digital artist, but An artist like that. Wow, look at that. He's holding up a Boba Fett.
That is some top-notch work.
Impressionistic. But anyway, sorry to derail the history question, but I wanted to let folks know that they were missing out of seeing all this great stuff in your studio or in your room.
How long have you been painting Star Wars on canvas like this?
I started 2018.
Oh, so just not that long ago.
Yeah. Not that long ago, and I chose a Darth Vader painting from Empire Strikes Back. Well, a Darth Vader moment, a shot. And it really was just to see if I could paint something that were, that looked kind of, you know, as like close as I can to the finished, you know, movie, so that people would see, mm-hmm. is that a photograph or is that the actual, you know. Mm. So I did it for just that one, and I thought it's a good subject matter because everybody knows every pixel of Star Wars, so if I mess up on something, they're going to be like, oh, doesn't look like Darth Vader. You know, it's easy to mess up Darth Vader's face.
You get
something out of proportion, it looks wrong, and people jump on it because people know every pixel.
You're saying Star Wars fans are picky? Like, we know every little dot, every... No.
Oh, here's a pencil drawing. Of me. It's a self-portrait.
Wow. That is amazing artwork. So this is a shot of Boba Fett on Docking Bay 94 right outside the Millennium Falcon ramp, as seen in Star Wars A New Hope.
Yep.
The special edition. I mean, I don't even think we have to call it the special edition anymore because they become the official versions of the film. So
That's a touchy subject because I always felt that George did himself a disservice by kind of pretending that the original versions never existed. I really wish he had said, these are the special editions. These are my originals, you know, pick and choose. And then all of us could kind of, you know, make our perfect New Hope, you know, put back the, the Greedo.
Mm-hmm. On shot first.
Conundrum. Yeah. Put certain things back. Takes certain things out and make our own perfect version. But I think he did himself a disservice by saying, these are the new movies, regardless of what you fans think. And I don't think that was a smart idea, and I wish he hadn't done it.
Well, did you know at the time, as you were working on the film, that's indeed what you were working on, which is the new definitive edition? Or did you think that you were working on something that was just kind of a little celebration, I guess, of the anniversary?
Yeah, because, I mean, what they told me is that you're working on a New Hope special edition, and just having that special edition makes you think, okay, well, this is a version.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
right.
It's a special edition. It's the special edition, not the original edition. The special edition. So I just assumed that they were going to have two versions of the movie, which is fine. Mm-hmm. And they were never, when I worked on New Hope, they were never going to have an Empire special edition. I don't know if you know that. They're never going to make a Return of the Jedi special edition. And had I known that, I probably would not have left ILM. I probably would have stayed at ILM for Empire and probably been in the suit for Return of the Jedi instead of Don Bees. He jumped in because I wasn't there.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, let's start at the beginning. When did you start at ILM, and what was your job there, and how did you slide into working on Star Wars?
Okay, well, they hired me to work on a different movie, to work on Casper.
Hmm.
And at the time, this is when CG animation is in its infancy. There weren't any, you know, experienced computer animators at that time. There were very, very few, maybe a handful, and they all worked at ILM, most of them. But they needed a crew of computer animators to work on this character animated character animation movie. Mm-hmm. And they wanted the animation to be or feel like a hybrid of 2D and 3D. So I got hired as a 2D animator that they were going to train in 3D to get the look that they desired for Spielberg. Spielberg was very adamant. He wanted it to have strong connections to the original Harvey cartoons. And so for that reason, most of the crew were 2D animators, and we all did 3D training, and in 10 weeks later, kind of released into the world of 3D animation as the animation crew for Casper. Mm-hmm. So it was during Casper that I met Don Bees and got kind of my back entrance to the archives because it was off limits.
Mm-hmm.
He knew I was a huge Boba Fett fan, and he set me up with my first gig in the suit, which was at Skywalker Ranch doing a summit that summer. This is summer of 1994.
Okay.
And he called me up and said, would you like to jump in the suit? I'd already been there and drooled over the armor and poured over it and put the helmet on and heaven. But he said, would you like to jump in the suit? And I was like, oh, my God. of course, yes. He goes, well, don't build your hopes up, because if the suit doesn't fit, then you won't be able to do it. And we'll find you an equally cool other character like that existed in my books. but that's what he said. And so the following lunchtime, I went to Skywalker Ranch, which is a good hour drive from ILM. And tried the flight suit on, and you know that zipper coming up was kind of my Cinderella slipper moment. You know, it fit, you know, and that was my entrance into being one of the guys that fit the suit. So this happened on Casper. This is completely unrelated to the creature animation I did for Special Edition, which came like a year later. That happened summer of 95, and this was summer of 94.
Mm-hmm.
So I had no clue at this time that I was going to be in the movie. I just knew I was in the suit. They said, such a hard task. You have to pretend to be Boba Fett for 4 hours in this. They completely built the Mos Eisley Cantina on one of the sound stages, complete with a bar with proper drinks and all the president of Kenner Toys, Dark Horse Comics were there, Bantam Books were there, all the license holders were there. And it was mainly for a big hype to say, we're going to be re-releasing the movies for this new generation that hasn't seen it in the theaters, like the kids of the fans.
Right.
So we want to re-release it. So with that re-release, there's probably a lot of marketing that can go along with it, obviously, because it's Star Wars. And so all these guests were kind of the VIPs or the license holders and you know, the bigwigs from all those companies I mentioned at the cantina. And we had to, there was aliens at tables. There was the band miming to the music in the corner. I had to go around and just, you know, they said, don't talk, kind of play this very much like Mickey Mouse in Disneyland. You know, he doesn't say anything. It's all mime, pantomime, and he writes his name, and he doesn't ever say, you know, hello, I'm Mickey Mouse or whatever. I was like, but I could probably rip off the voice. And no, not allowed to talk. Not allowed to talk. Don't talk. Okay. And so 4 hours I was in that suit, and it was heaven. It was the best experience, because it was like a VR. It was like virtual reality, except you could bump into the tables and you could bump into the aliens. And, you know, and I'd make a face at an alien and they'd cower away. And it was completely like so, a mind trip.
Mark, just so the listeners are clear, what you're describing with this recreation of the cantina was for this special event with all of these licensees just, and the VIPs. Yeah. It wasn't for the special editions.
Was this on the scoring stage at Sky
Sound? Yeah, it was one of the sound stages. I'm not sure which one. Because we were just herded into a room somewhere, you know, it was packed with volunteers. Chewbacca was getting dressed, you know, the stormtroopers were getting dressed. So it was in this tiny room with double doors that opened into what was the Mos Eisley Cantina. And so I'm not sure what the sound stage looked like, other than through a small visor, you know, with lots of dry ice in the air, like lots of smoke.
Sounds amazing.
Like I said, it looked like the cantina bar, and had, you know, real patrons as well as, you know, volunteers in alien costumes.
Kind of what we thought that you know, Star Wars Land at Disney would actually look like. That it would be like stepping into the set of one of the films. You know.
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't know what to expect, because they never told me what was through the double doors. They just said, you know, because guests were already in there. They were in there. They were getting drinks, and then it got populated very quickly.
Mark, I'm picturing you like Arnold Schwarzenegger in Turbo Man. You just they put the costume on you real quick, and then they just shove you onto the float, and you're like, "Whoa, where am I? What am I doing? Oh, I get to act like Boba Fett. I'll do it." It's like your Turbo Man moment.
Yeah, it really was. And the thing is that, you know, it got to maybe 2 hours in, and I was in heaven. I was in, because I'm the biggest Boba Fett fan at ILM. That's why Don called me. I was in heaven. So I'd get some guy kind of, you know, out of costume, come and grab my arm. So you've got to take a break. I was like, no, I'm fine. No, you've got to take a break. We have to make you take at least a 5-minute break. So I was like a kid, you know, in detention. I had my helmet on my lap, and I was just sitting there. Okay, I've drunk. Can I go back in? No, wait there 5 minutes. Waiting to go back in. And even when it finished, nobody wanted to get out of costume. And they put the music on, like they played regular music, and everyone was in costume dancing. It was
the best experience. So this was an event that was to get the licensees all hyped up, saying, hey, Star Wars is coming back. It's coming back on the big screen. At this point, you're working for ILM. You're working on Casper, which, by the way, I love that movie. I've never really talked about it on RFR, but it is such a good film. And
it had so much to do with heralding in the new generation of CGI characters. Casper was one of the first, like, leading CGI characters in a film. And then ILM eventually evolved that into Jar Jar Binks, and the rest is history.
Yeah. Yeah, and I was the animation lead for Casper as well. So super privileged. I was on top of the world. Summer of 94... I was absolutely like, you know, I thought I'd won the lottery.
Yeah.
I was working for the George and at ILM and living in California. And I expected to be there 18 months, because my contract was for just the run of picture. So it's just for Casper. Mm. I knew I was going to be here for, like, you know, until July of 95.
Is that typical, Mark, in that business, that you would end up working for an effects company for a specific film project?
Yes.
That's typical. Okay.
When a film is greenlit, when it's got the official go ahead and the studio have greenlit it, in other words, this is like, okay, the train's rolling. That's when they hire the crew that they need to make the movie. And so it's a frantic kind of process, I guess, for those guys. I've been in a situation as well, being in the special effects industry myself, and had to hire a crew to work on, I don't know, 40, 50 movies now.
Wow. See, I just had this image that at a company like ILM or Skywalker Sound, that there's you know, people that have been there 15, 20, 25 years that work on every film. And that doesn't seem to be the way that, that it works, really.
Well, there were people that were more experienced that were working at ILM, but they needed an entire crew just devoted to this one movie. You know, because we're making Casper in a small kind of corner of ILM. Over here is like Forrest Gump. Over here is The Mask, which was another great movie.
Yeah.
Over here was they were gearing up for Dragonheart, you know. So ILM's divided into camps. And we were dubbed kind of Casper Land where we were. And so because they needed such a big crew, we needed a crew of like 25, 30 animators. And so that's why they had to hire so many people and train them in the computer to have that many hands on deck. Because, like I said, there weren't any computer animators back then. We were kind of the newbies, but also the kind of the spearhead for computer effects and animation back then.
You guys were the young guns bringing the new tech to ILM. And so then how did you get picked to work on the special edition, and what scenes did you work on?
Okay. Well, we heard rumors, like what 1994, there were no rumors, but early 95, rumors started to trickle down. And, you know, I'd heard rumors before, but rumors at ILM, you tend to take, you know, give a bit more weight to. So they were saying that they were going to hire two animators to work on A New Hope. And I was like, oh, damn it. No, I'm probably going to get sent home in June. Lucky whoever gets picked, you know?
Yeah.
And so in June, they said, you have to go up to, I finished my last shot on Casper. It was all wrapping up. And you know, said my goodbyes to the producer and the production crew and went up to HR. I thought I was going to be given my details on my flight or, you know, however I was going to get the hell home. And they said, and I, like I said, there's only rumors about them hiring two people. So I really didn't see much chance, you know, even though I was the lead for Casper. I didn't think that no one had said anything beyond this movie. And I was happy just to work on that movie, you know. So when I went to HR and they said, oh, we could have you down as a full-time employee and you're one of the animators on New Hope Special Edition, I went, sure.
Wait. That's how you found out?
HR told me.
You found out. You're in a meeting for – yeah, right. You're in a meeting with HR. Yeah. You're talking about, I don't know, your medical benefits, and they go, oh, let me look this up. Oh yeah, you're one of the two animators working on the Star Wars thing. Yeah, you should get your new membership card in the mail next week. Like,
Is that incredible. Okay? No, they said, is that okay? So I said, of course it's okay. You know, I just have to call my mom and tell her. You
know? Isn't that odd though? Shouldn't a department head be bringing you in to tell you this stuff? An HR rep? That's weird.
Maybe they probably let it slip, you know, because that's right. Things like that do happen in the industry. Because there's an army of people organizing, it's very easy to, for someone to step ahead of someone else. Oh, sorry. That should have been him telling you that, you know. It's happened a lot. It's happened a lot. But, you know, the two animators went down to one animator before this happened as well. Because John Knoll came along and said, oh, I'm going to be doing all the spaceship shots. So I was like, oh, damn it. It's got all the spaceship shots. So all they needed was someone to do creatures. And because we'd done Casper, which was kind of, you know, an anatomical, you know, character, they thought, oh, if you can do Casper, you could probably do some, you know, dinosaur-esque creatures for New Hope. So the first things I had to do tests for were the Ronto and the Dewback. And come up with a walk cycle, and and the rest is history.
Wow,
I was really amazed with the Dewback and how mobile it was. And I recall seeing a Ben Burtt IMAX documentary. I think this was even before I saw the special edition, where he had IMAX footage of the Dewback walking in the sand. And I thought it was just absolutely fascinating. Are you familiar with that documentary?
No, I haven't seen it. I didn't know they'd exposed it before then.
I think they did.
Unless, that first shot.
The Dubek or the Ronto?
The first shot of the Dubek was the one with the Lambda shuttle taken off and you got the stormtroopers in the foreground.
Yes.
And the Dubek comes in. There's another one coming forward. And that, because it was the first shot out the gate, it wasn't actually that one. It was the other one where it walks across the screen. I have a story about this one, though. But that shot was, because it was the first one out the gate, everybody was in on dailies. And it was like, there were like 25 opinions about every detail. And people were pulling it this way and that way. And, oh, the leg should be raised up here on this frame. And the hip's meant to be up. And, they're pulling it this way and that. And I was in the middle just being tugged this way and this way. No, I'm the new guy.
All you had was the original footage, which was just a big rubber head on a stick. And so just out of curiosity, since you're working on creatures, I mean, do you have any history in zoology, or did you go out and look at lizards? What kind of research did you do as you were sort of trying to make this thing, you know, go from just a head to, you know, a full bodied moving creature?
It wasn't so much the lizards, because lizards are very much a different anatomy. They move very differently. I looked more at dinosaurs, you know, dinosaur movies. They finished Jurassic Park, you know. Jurassic Park had come out the year before I joined. And so all the Jurassic Park guys were there kind of chiming in what they thought should be happening. Mm-hmm. And the result was, it's been pulled so many ways, it ended up looking kind of very stop motion animation. It was very kind of, for me anyway, I see it. It's that one of the two shots I'd love to redo.
You need your special edition.
They've had enough special editions.
Yeah, but the fact that it has that sort of stop motion, I mean, is there a sense, you know, to you, that, I mean, if that's sort of, you know, part of Star Wars' roots? I mean, you've got sort of stop motion with the Tauntauns, and was that sort of, I'm just so curious, when you were trying to marry the traditional effects, the models and all of that, with the computer generated effects, were you trying to create some continuity there, or did you have the freedom to just say, hey, we've got these new tools, they offer more capabilities than anything in the physical world, we're just gonna go for it?
Well, the thing is, you mentioned the stop motion that was in the original trilogy, when the original movies in 1977 to 83, but they had just come out with Jurassic Park, which was a departure from that stop motion feel. And you know, they could get creatures feeling very naturalistic in the way they moved. So I was, after this first, each shot was budgeted separately. And so this first shot out the gate, like I said, that everyone had opinions about, went over budget. And so I said to the producer, I said, look, if you can just, I'm the animation guy here. You hired me to do the animation. If you give me the animation kind of say, and they can chime in about how it's lit and how it, you know, is comped into the plate. But if you leave the animation to me, it will be cheaper and cheaper, you know, that, with a producer, that word registers.
Sure.
So following that first shot, I was kind of like the animation director from that point onwards for the creatures. And so the next one out was the one you showed the picture of the guy on the stormtrooper kind of coaxing the Dubek round. This one. Originally, this shot was a very ugly shot. Originally, this shot was just... I have a Dubek here to demonstrate. Originally, this shot was just a Dubek's butt in camera, very close.
Dubek
very
butt.
Close. And all it did was walk away from camera.
Just walking
up that
away.
Hill. Yeah. Oh. So I blocked it out. And when you block out, you don't do the walking. You slide it because you want a determination on how fast. So then you know what size pace it needs to take. Mm-hmm. So I did that version. I blocked it out. And then I put in another version where I had, well, let's do it. I'm mirroring.
Cool. For those listening to the podcast, he actually has a Hasbro Dewback with the Tatooine Stormtrooper, and he's kind of acting this out for us, demoing. This is so cool. Yeah.
So I had it facing the camera, because then you get to see its face, and I had the Stormtrooper kind of coax it so that it turns, and then it ends up and it cuts still the same place it ended. So I put those two versions into dailies, and the producer, his name was Tom Kennedy, he saw them prior to George coming down. And he said, what's this other shot? I said, this is an alternate version, you know. You can choose version A, which is the bald right. version, or B, which is my less ugly version. Yes. He goes, no, you take it out. That's disrespectful to Mr. Lucas. And so...
Where's the butt? I asked for the butt.
But then my point was, he has the butt version, you know.
Right.
If he chooses A, his butt. If he chooses B,
you're giving
face.
The man options.
Yeah, exactly. But he said, no, that's disrespectful. Disrespectful. Oh. I said, he has absolute power. There's no disrespect.
Yeah.
I absolutely respect the man. So he said, no, go upstairs and delete it. So I was up there.
Delete it?
Hovering,
oh, my God.
Hovering over the delete button from dailies.
Hmm.
And I was like, you know what? I was a cocky bastard back then. You know what? I'm gonna leave it in. I'm going to leave it in. So we're down there, and it comes up on the screen, and they ran all the shots.
I want to clarify. So you're in the screening room with George Lucas and the producer, right? Or no?
No.
Oh, okay.
I'm in there with the producer.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you imagine the screen in the middle is dailies. In the bottom, there's a tiny kind of strip, and that's mm-hmm. a camera pointed at us.
Oh,
so you can
okay.
see the producer, gotcha. The effects supervisor in the front row, some other guys, the modelers and textures, uh-huh. and it's me way at the back. And in the top strip is two halves. There's one half. This is George Lucas, but in his San Anselmo house.
Mm-hmm.
His loft. On this side, it's Skywalker Ranch and it's Rick McCallum.
Mm.
So there's a big producer, and then there's the ILM producer down with me on the bottom.
Gotcha.
So the dailies plays, and the butt shot comes up. Everyone's happy, and the producer's there in the front, happy, smiling. He looked like the guy from MASH with the glasses, the priest.
Oh,
really mild-mannered, kind of, you know, a nice kind of...
William Christopher.
He's there. He's smiling.
Uh-huh.
And then suddenly my shot comes up, and he suddenly, you can see steam coming out of his ears. And,
oh,
you know, he didn't say anything, but he went red. His face went red. And he's like, didn't know what to say. And George says, oh, what's this? And my hand goes up. And I says, sorry, Mr. Lucas, this is just an alternate version. And that's all I said. Uh-huh. And then that just saying that sparked this whole conversation. Like, suddenly he went from being kind of like blasé and kind of nonchalant to like getting engaged, and somebody started talking about it and saying about how it should be kind of feel like a cowboy kind of trying to get a reluctant horse to turn. You know, there should be some resistance there. And then finally it kind of comes around. And he was like engaged, he was chatting, blah, 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 blah. And came out of his kind of malaise, better word to describe
just
it.
Kind of that sort of that typical George kind of just nonplussed.
Exactly that. And he came out of this shell, and it was great. Right.
I think George so cultivates cool. this atmosphere around himself that limits surprise. He doesn't get surprised very often. Everyone is just tripping over themselves trying to do whatever George wants. Nobody throws things at him, so he doesn't get surprised. He's
protected.
Just...
He has his own force field.
Yeah.
He has his yes men. He has his yes men standing there to say, oh, that's a great idea, Mr. Lucas. Like, mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what he says. He could, like, you know, burp, and they'd say, oh, it's a great idea, Mr. Lucas. Like, anything that comes out, they're ready to acknowledge and praise. And I guess after years of that, you've got to get, like, kind of, you know,
right.
He's inside this protected bubble, but he's kind of
separated
from the world a bit.
Yes, and he was sort of the antithesis of that, in the sense that he went to film school where they beat up each other's projects and worked together, and then he kind of created his own you know, film school. He's got Zemeckis and Spielberg and various others, you know, looking at those initial prints of
De Palma.
De Palma,
don't
right?
Forget famously, De Palma.
De Palma, of course. And
Coppola.
And Coppola, you're so, who of course doesn't mince words. And so isn't that interesting that that was such a big part of his creative process as a up and coming filmmaker? And then it was lost because of his status and his stature and, you know, the sycophantic maybe way that people follow him, I guess.
Really?
Yeah, how did challenges.
How did they land on your alternate? How did they decide, hey, this is the one
he
we're
said,
gonna use?
Like I said, as soon as we got engaged about it, it was obvious that he had rejected the other one because he was talking about how what we could I could add into it to make it the shot. You know, he had ideas and was stimulated, I guess, is a good word. There's a couple of times that happened. There was another time I was doing a shot and it was a stormtrooper dismounting off of a dewback outside the cantina. And there's R2 and 3PO in the foreground. And I had this dewback kind of sniff the backpack of the trooper that was their live-action trooper in the plate.
Mm-hmm.
And George looking at the trooper dismounting, and he's like, where did you get that footage from, talking to Tom Kennedy? And Tom Kennedy said, Mark, that's animated, that's hand-animated. And he's like, no. And I shook him. I shook him.
Nice.
And suddenly he was out of his shell again and engaged. And there's only one other time that happened, and that kind of went, it landslid the wrong way. It was a shot of, and for those who are not watching and listening, I have a Ronto in my hand.
Yes.
But it was a shot of a Ronto. There had been many Ronto shots, but this shot was a big open square, and there's a Ronto walking through and a speeder bike weaving through, and that was it.
Mm-hmm.
And I put it into dailies and I thought, I'm done. And then suddenly George said, where's the guy who's holding the rope? That Ronto hasn't got a rider or anyone leading it. And it irked him. So I said, well, we could have someone riding it. We only have stormtroopers though. Do we have any Jawas? And of course, the yes men are like, oh no, but we can get them. You know, yes, yeah, we can get them. And that started this snowball where it became, first of all, is adding a Jawa, then it became two Jawas, then it was a Jawa falling off the back, then it was him rearing up, and the Jawa falls off the back, and the other one's hanging and swinging around, and the speeder swerves in, and it just landslid into this big, I don't know, I thought I was done. I thought I was finished. And suddenly it became this huge thing, which doesn't fit in the movie. It's not, it was an establishing shot. An establishing shot, traditionally, not much happens in establishing shot. It's usually a kind of a lock off. Mm-hmm. It's usually, you know, all you're saying is, this is where the following shots take place. And suddenly this great big Cirque du Soleil kind of experience evolved.
Gosh,
in the space of about 5 minutes.
Mark, I cannot tell you how cool it is to hear you talking about this because, you know, we've been living with these versions of the films for so long. And that I'll be honest with you, it's not that I didn't like that moment, but it does sort of jump out at me every time that I see it because you're right. It's so un-Star Wars-y in a sense that, you know, when you compare it to the establishing shots, as you mentioned, of, you know, traditional Lucas, where there's not a lot of busyness going on.
No.
And this is sort of like Marx Brothers or, you know, I don't know. I mean, just kind of...
Slapsticky.
Slapstick, that's the... Exactly. Slapsticky.
But I'll tell you this, that image of the Ronto with the speeder heading toward it in Mos Eisley, it was used in countless pieces of promotion for the film.
Yeah.
They said, see Star Wars like you've never seen it before. And there's that Ronto kicking up with the speeder bike flying by. It was in commercials and trailers and all that stuff. Yeah. It was just really, I mean, that had to make you feel good when it was happening, right?
It did if I wasn't so embarrassed about it. Because for me, I just felt like there was a couple of other shots that kind of landslid. And once George had kind of seen it, when it was finished, he realized his mistake and said, you know what, we should go back to, you know, and he changed his mind. After I left ILM, somebody went back to visit and they came back with the rumor about Greedo. And I said, that's probably one of those incidents where George has tried it. He'll see it. He'll see, obviously this doesn't work because it takes away Han Solo's arc. He has to be the scoundrel to become the hero by the end of the movie. You know, that's his arc. So it's probably one of those things he's tried and he's going to reject. Because there were some other ideas he had and rejected. And I thought that was one. And it's only when I saw the premiere at Man's Chinese Theatre and that shot came up, and I was like, oh my God, he wasn't lying. It's
wow. So you didn't, you thought it was just rumor until you actually were at the premiere.
Because I was just in charge of Preachers.
Right.
Except for Jabba. Jabba was Steve Williams or Spaz Williams. Spaz Williams was the guy who directed me for the blue screen shoot. He was like the Uber, you know, he was like the Glenn Keane or the Walt Disney of CG animation at that point. He was the guy that did the Terminator 2 walking out the fire. He did the water tentacle in the abyss. He did the T-Rex in Jurassic Park. I mean, he was like the guy.
Totally iconic. I mean, totally iconic. But can I ask, because we've talked on this show recently about that and the evolution of that computer-generated Jabba throughout the years. Yeah. What was it or what is it about that puppet from 1983, 1982, that seems to be so difficult to achieve via computer, where with latex and slime and paint and the right lighting just comes across as so real? I'm very curious how you would describe that.
Well, they've only recently, and I'm talking about the last 5 years, I think, 5-6 years, managed to make truly believable creatures, you know, like Jungle Book, where you like, wow, it's a talking panther, you know? It's only been since 2015 that the technology has gotten to such a point where, you know, that you can pull those kind of shots off. My argument was bring back the puppet at the time. It's like, why are we doing this? We should just get the puppet. The puppet was as real as any other, you know, actor, as real as Carrie Fisher, as real as Mark Hamill, Jabba the Hutt. You know, this puppet was real. And I couldn't understand why they had something that worked perfectly, and then they opted to go, and it was this, it was because George was excited about CG. He was excited about the fact that you could recycle computer animation. You know, if you animated a Stap droid standing up, you can copy that animation and make it 1,000 Stap droids just with one piece of animation. Even on this show, he was obsessed with the recycling or reusability of computer technology. So I couldn't understand why, when he wanted to rear back, as his neck reared back, his chest really moved a lot. And at the time, this is my second year doing computer animation. I was very unknowledgeable at that time.
Well, you picked a really small film to cut your teeth
out, huh? Yeah. We were all learning.
Start at the bottom and work your way up.
But the neck joints were towards the back of the neck. So a very small movement at the back would make a very large movement in the front because it was so far back. Underneath the Geronto, believe it or not, is the Brachiosaur from Jurassic Park.
Underneath?
They took the skin off of the Brachiosaur and they just put a new shell on it. And that was the Geronto. The scurriers that were more successful, I had them hopping out of the way of characters in Mos Eisley and running out of the way of the speeder. They were velociraptors with new skin.
Holy crap.
He was obsessed with the reusability of computer technology. And so for that reason, and that reason alone, is why he was obsessed to make Jabba CG work. And there was a point where it never did look right. The eyes were wrong. The eyes are not slanted.
The eyes are weird. Yeah.
They're not right. There's things that don't line up. It's unforgivable nowadays to pass that Jabba off as like the final. But there's a shot where Han goes around the back, and mm-hmm. they didn't mess with the footage. They had Han go around the back, and it looked okay. And then somebody said, "What about Jabba's tail?" And I'm like, "No. Who doesn't matter? Just this is movie magic. Leave it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Don't do that. Don't go there. Don't open that can of worms."
Yes.
And once someone had said it, it became a thing. And then they opted to make, you know, do that whole thing where he walks over.
Yeah. And then Jabba does that. Like he does that.
Yeah. You know, like his eyes bulge out of his head and stuff. It's crazy. Yeah.
There were working on that show, there were a lot. It was very cool for me. Mm. I'm so glad I did it. But there were a lot of choices that I didn't agree with, and but you know, who am I to say, hey, George?
Yeah,
don't do that. You know,
I love this. You don't have to prove your Star Wars fan cred to me at all, because you complain just as much as any other fan, and you were actually in the film. You actually worked on the film, and you complain about it as much as any other fan. So you, sir, are the true fan. Yeah,
I was complaining about it before anybody else.
Right? I was the first to hate on this special. Hey, did you do the ASP-7 droid? Was that a character that you worked on in the special edition?
It'd be the big clunky one, yeah?
Yeah, the clunky one, yeah, that punches.
I did the walk cycle, and we had him in a couple of shots. And like I said, they said, okay, you're finished. And I thought I was done. I didn't know I was going to do any more special editions. Disney were like calling, when are you going to come down? When are you going to come down? Mm. And so December of 95, I took off for Disney. Mm. And after I'd gone is when they decided, oh, actually, we're not quite finished. And one of the things that were and added afterwards was that thumping of the little probe droid.
Yeah.
And so when I saw the premiere, I had some surprises. You know, those things weren't as I'd left them. There were shots in there that I didn't know they were going to do. I had no clue about, you know, opening up the sand canyon for, you know, where it pans down to show R2-D2. That was a surprise. Mm. I had no idea about Ben's house. I'd never seen any of that footage. All I'd seen were things like the cleanup. They'd done lots of cleanup for like the flames of the wirings. They changed it from pink to yellow because on the original blue screen, once you get rid of the blue, the flames lose their yellow and become more pink looking. And so there were a lot of things, a lot of surprises when I first saw that.
When you,
premiere.
And so let us give us an idea of what it was like to be on the set for the shooting of the sequence in Docking Bay 94 with, you weren't there with all of them, but what was it like? Was it all blue screen or green screen? Was there anything practical there on the set with you?
No.
What did it look like?
There was a blue. All the floor was blue, and it went up into a blue backdrop. Mm-hmm. You know, it was just a whole lot of blue. Mm-hmm. And the only thing on the floor were you know, my start position was like a little kind of X, and my end position was another X for that first shot. So you start walking here, end there, and stop. On the second shot, there was another mark they put on the rear blue screen wall, which was the last known position of Harrison Ford's eye line as he went up the ramp. So I could look, as I am in this picture, I'm looking towards that mark on the blue screen that showed where Chewie and Han disappeared up the ramp. Mm-hmm. So that was it. There was a start position. Wow. Oh, and that second shot, there was a start position, a pause position, and then a walk-off position. You know, so I had to stop at that mark, check out, make sure everything was cool, and then exit. And everyone says, you know, why are you looking at the camera? And I didn't know I was until I saw the rushes come in, because, you know, I'm in the suit.
Right.
So, you know, I'm doing this, but the T-visor lines up square on. And Steve Williams, nobody said, hey, you looks like you're looking in camera. I'm relying on those guys to say it, because I can't tell. I can't tell. But George loved the fact. Mm-hmm. He said, oh, it looks like Boba Fett's mugging the camera.
It's badass. I think it's a badass move. Yeah. I really like it.
But it's the exclamation point on Boba Fett's cameo.
The first time I saw it,
I was like, wait, did I just see Boba Fett in Docking Bay 94? Boba Fett's in A New Hope now? And then with the scene ending with him giving almost a knowing glance toward the camera, looking at the audience saying, bet you didn't think you'd see me here, huh? Well, I'm here. Yeah, that's the vibe I got from that. And it was just like such a wonderful rush, you know, just it really just tickled my inner fancy knowing that, oh, finally, Boba is now in all three films of the original trilogy. Yeah. This is right. This feels right.
Mark, what
and
can
that
you...
was exactly George's reaction as well. Mm-hmm. But when people say, why did you look in the camera? I really wasn't. But it's okay that it looks like that, you know? Mm-hmm.
Mark, what can you tell us about the suit that you wore on the set and then also at that event that you were, the licensee event you were talking about? Was it right out of the archives? Is this the Jeremy Bullock suit? Was this a prop? Was this a replica? What was it?
It was, well, all the suit, there's so many pieces, and the pieces are never kept together. They're just pieces. They have enough suits, according to Don Bees. He said they have enough pieces to probably make 4 or 5 full Boba Fett suits. Just because, you know, on set, if something breaks, something gets busted, something falls off, they have a replacement they can just slap on. They don't have to stop filming to fabricate something.
Right.
So this is actually the same suit I wore for the summit. And when I was at the summit, I said to the... have someone help you get dressed, because it's very hard to get dressed on your own. I said to the guy, I said, the shoulder bells are swapped. And he goes, well, don't worry about it. We can't change it now. They're not Velcro. So, you know, okay. I said, forget I even said it. You know, I don't want to say I don't want to do it. Like, that's not what I'm saying. I'm just pointing it out. And if it's not an easy fix, then screw it. I don't care. So, like I said, did the summit. It ended up, the summit was so successful, we did the second summit, and I wore the same suit again. And that was the same suit that they picked out. They just rolled it out for the blue screen shoot, because they knew all the pieces were there. They'd already had it, you know, worn twice that year.
Yeah.
You know, earlier, the summer of that year. I turned up on the set, and Annie Polland was my wardrobe lady. She was the same wardrobe lady for Return of the Jedi. So she dressed Dickie Beers and Jeremy for Return of the Jedi. And so I said to her, I said, you realize these shoulder bells are swapped? She goes, I don't worry, because the cape's this side, but the cape doesn't cover it up. You know, when she did it, the cape kind of covered it a little bit.
Yeah.
But as soon as we start filming, it exposed. And so people are very angry about the fact that he's
I didn't know this was a thing. I'm assuming that a lot of the anger is either from the costumers or the action figure guys, because they probably want this variant action figure of this particular
I want the variant action figure.
I would never, you know, it's so funny because, like, I'm a huge fan, obviously, but this kind of stuff, it's hard for me to see. It's hard for me to notice the differences in the Vader costume from film to film. And I know that Boba Fett, you know, changes colors and things from, you know, Empire to Jedi. So when I see something like this, I mean, it's amazing to me that you, especially in that time when the internet was relatively new, so you,
it was.
So you only knew first, this from having seen the movies over and over and over.
Yeah.
It's incredible.
But the thing is that those guys that complain will say they're true fans for complaining. I think the true fans are more forgiving. If you are a true fan of Star Wars, you are more forgiving of anything that is Star Wars. I think that describes, for me, a true fan. You love Star Wars, the franchise, enough to kind of gloss over things that really don't matter, like how come there's blood on the severed, you know, Ponda Baba arm? Should it be cauterized? Who cares? Who cares? I call them the recreationally outraged. That's what Joe Rogan once said. Perfect. Recreationally outraged.
Didn't you get a little recreationally outraged when Lego released the Slave One ship and they just called it Boba Fett's starship? Didn't you get a little recreationally outraged?
Yeah, I don't think it's recreationally outraged. I kept getting these...
I think your dog is recreationally outraged right now. He needs a walk.
I was going to say before we start, I said, if Wookiee starts barking, it's out of my control. You know?
Perfect name. Perfect name.
But the I kept getting these tweets or messages on Instagram or Facebook saying, what do you think about the name change? And I'm like, what the hell are people talking about? And, you're Boba Fett. What do you think about it? You're Boba Fett. What do you think about it? And I had to look up what they were talking about. And then I read this article saying about the name change for the Lego set. And so I thought, okay, well, I was more upset than mad. I was upset because, PC has gotten so out of control. I was kind of just bummed when they labeled the Slave Leia, Jabba's prisoner. It's like, oh, come on. It's Slave Leia, Slave Leia. Yeah. And so when they started picking on Slave One, I was like annoyed, but I was also upset because I knew regardless of the outcome, it was going to be a thing from this point onwards. Like you said, it's a thing we're talking about, and it will forever be associated with Slave One ship. You know, everyone's going to have that at the back of their mind. It's kind of marred. There's a kind of dirty stain on Slave One just because they made it an issue. You know, they brought it up.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. So it's so funny. It's a lot of times it's like it's the people that notice something that are the ones that really seem to have the guilty conscience in a way. You know, it's like, well, no one had a problem with this until some executives at Lego said, I don't think this is appropriate anymore. It's like, wait a minute, what are you reading into this? This thing's been around for, 40 some years.
Yeah.
All of a sudden you've got a problem with it.
The name itself actually is steeped in ILM history. The way that the starship was named in the first place was there was an internal contest at ILM, and everyone pitched in their names, and that was chosen as the winner, Slave One.
Yeah, and it's so perfect. If you're going to give Boba Fett an edgy named ship, that's perfect. It's so perfect for making it ominous and kind of dark. So I heard this, and so I just posted, how far is this going to go? Is a Death Star next,
Well, how far is it going to go? Right. That is a good question.
And it's a joke, but it's not really a joke. Yeah.
I just ordered my Life Star playset from Lego.
Life
it's
Star.
Brand new. it's the Life Star.
It's Star Friends. It's not Star Wars. Star Friends.
Tell you what, Mark, this has been one of the most fun, interesting, fascinating interviews we've had the privilege of doing in a long time.
Cool.
But we do want to make sure, and we'd love to have you back and talk more with you. But we do want to talk a little bit about your YouTube channel, the Boba Fett Fan Club right now. And these videos are great because you're doing the series called No Disintegrations.
Oh, yeah.
And this is a lot of fun because it's you in the Boba Fett suit and kind of giving life advice. I don't know how you would call it. You describe it and tell us what this is.
Well, on the Boba Fett Fan Club, they always had this as a flash animation, the kind of cutout animation of Boba Fett talking, done by an Australian guy. And so I guess the Australian guy said to the guy who runs the fan club, his name is Aaron Proctor, he said, how about doing a live action version? I'll write them and we do a live action version. So Aaron met me for drinks and over margaritas. He said, how do you, you know, what do you feel about jumping in the suit and doing this kind of spoof series? And I was like, yeah, it's great. Let's do it. And I thought there's going to be about five. And end up 22 episodes. So, you know, I guess I've played Boba Fett, you know, 23 times.
Yeah.
I guess.
Jason had me pull this one quick clip here. Can you fire it off, Jason?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So this was cool. I like this. The episode was called Beware of the Cute. And I can't help but think that maybe this was a response. I didn't look at the date. I just felt like maybe it was a response to Baby Yoda appearing on The Mandalorian. But this is Boba Fett. Oh, it was way before. Oh, how prescient the writers were on this, because it's Boba Fett talking about, you know, how to, you know, hey, when there's something cute, you should have your guard up. So here it is.
Remember the old spacefarer's motto. See something cute, get ready to shoot.
Now, see, that's a good sounding Boba Fett voice, too.
It's
you
a great
kidding.
Boba Fett voice.
You could have done it at that licensing summit at Skywalker Ranch. No question about it.
Of course, at that time, it would have been the original voice. That would have been.
Yeah, yeah. It was so much fun doing that series. Like I said, the guy in Australia wrote them, and some of these pages would be like 4 pages long. I said, "Wow, Boba Fett's got to talk this much."
Never talked that much.
it never spoke this much before, and so it was. It's the very first episodes. I used my suit that I had, and then very quickly people kept pinging and saying, "Oh, look, you can see your neck," or "That's wrong," or "This is loose," or "That should be better." So we end up getting a cosplayer, one of these professional kind of cosplayers in. So I jumped into his suit for the remainder of the series. So you can see, if you look at them in order, you can see a change in the suit. It evolves into a much better suit.
Okay. I mean, were there any pieces of the ILM suit, or excuse me, the official suit that you were able to squirrel away, keep?
A button fell off of one of the gloves. There was a button on the glove,
yeah,
and it fell off at the summit, and I picked it up, and I kept that button. But that's the only
piece. But how many people can say? I mean,
as I took everything off, they literally dropped it into this box, and I was like, oh my God, you know.
It's sacred. How dare you?
Yeah. And they're like, they're taking the shoulder belt and shut. Like, what the?
Oh, man.
But yeah, they checked everything off as I took it off. They were very, very careful.
But you got that button.
I had one of the Stormtrooper helmets, not this one, like the actual helmet, on my desk for the 6 months I was working on the shots. And the reason I had it on my desk is because I was so happy that I had got picked to do the animation, because there were a lot of people that didn't care about Star Wars working at ILM. You might find it hard to believe, but there were a lot of people at ILM didn't care about Star Wars.
So I think there are a lot of people at Lucasfilm these days that don't care about Star Wars, to be honest with you. Just my personal opinion.
when I got the original CG Stormtrooper, he looked like someone wearing aviator glasses and like he was unhappy. I'm drawing you a picture, but this isn't far off of the actual look that they gave me. and I said to them, this is not on model. The lenses are more triangular. It's meant to be curved, curved between the helmet here. And so they said, well, if we give you a Stormtrooper helmet, could you put it into it was Softimage back then, into Softimage and pull it with lattices and reshape it? So I actually made the Stormtrooper helmet that you see in the movie, because the guy who modeled it obviously didn't care. Mm. He didn't. Mm. He just gave me this weird, it looked like a bug.
Yeah, it looks like a ghost from Pac-Man you're holding up there instead of a Stormtrooper helmet. Oh, it really does.
There's no backpacks either, so I had to model. I didn't know modeling, but I quickly stayed after hours and learned modeling on in soft homage and made the entire backpack and the little pole they hold, these things, you know, these little kind of lance things.
Yeah.
So I made the helmet and the backpack and the whatever he's holding here. But they gave me a Dubak that was naked as well. It had no saddle, mm-hmm. had no reins. They gave me just a bare Dubak. And I said, but what's he sitting on? And I had to send it back. So that instead of modeling the saddle on the skin, which would be much easier, they just sent me a separate saddle. But as the skin moved around, it came through the saddle. So I had to animate the saddle to not allow the skin to go through. It was...
Wow.
I called it virtual duct tape and super glue back then.
Well, thank you so much for paying such close attention to that and not giving us fans headaches for, you know, the next like quarter said, century looking at that thing, because it would have been brutal.
Yeah, there was a lot of people that didn't care and, you know, just didn't care. And so I'm so glad I got picked, because there's one shot where when he's pulling the reins to coax the Dubak round, you could see mm-hmm. sunlight in his armpit. There was a hole. So I said, this is wrong. They said, I'll just stick a sphere. So I made a sphere, mm-hmm. colored it black, made it matte, and I just parented it to his arm so that it covered that hole.
Before we let you go, I wanted to let you know about this Ben Burt documentary. I had to look up the information.
I'll write it down.
Because I haven't seen it since 1996. It was actually released a year before the Star Wars Special Editions. And in my quick research I did here, it's called Special Effects, Anything Could Happen. It was an IMAX exclusive documentary directed by Ben Burt, narrated by John Lithgow, and it was released to IMAX only theaters in 1996. This documentary film is an exploration of special effects techniques used in motion pictures, including traditional special effects up to modern computer generated effects. It is also notable for featuring the making of the new digital effects created for the special edition version of Star Wars A New Hope, which was released to theaters 1 year later in 1997. And I recall seeing this film at the Museum of Science and Industry on Chicago's South Side in their IMAX theater. And I just saw it the one time. And I remember, Jason just put up the poster for the film. I remember just being completely gobsmacked by that Dubak footage that I was seeing for the very first time. To see a Dubak in motion was just... It was an amazing experience for me, being the kid who grew up in the 70s with the Kenner plastic toy and always wondering, how come we never really saw this guy in the movie? Well, now we do, and thanks to your hard work. But if you have a chance, I don't know where you can possibly see this documentary. It was only 40 minutes long, created for IMAX exclusively, as I said. So I don't think it's in any kind of circulation or anything right now. If anybody in our listening audience can tip us off onto where we can see this documentary today, that would be great. But as far as I know, it was only released in IMAX theaters for a limited time.
And it's not on YouTube?
It must be.
Everything's on YouTube. Let's just look. I mean, I'll punch it up right now, and it'll be like, oh, mystery solved. special effects, anything can happen. But, I mean, do things really make it from IMAX to YouTube?
We'll find out. But I thought it was cool on the movie poster that
here it is.
You saw the X-Wing.
All right. Well, I'm telling you what, I'm seeing it. Yep. It appears it's there. And I might be looking at it. I don't know what I'm looking at. But, yeah, search it out. Mark, I think you'd find it interesting at the very least.
Yeah, I definitely will look it up.
Mark, I'd love to have you back on and talk about talk more about this, other projects you've been involved with. I got to tell you, it's just been an absolute honor and delight to talk to you and to hear firsthand behind the scenes of these stories, of these new scenes that we saw. They're not new now, but they were mind-blowing, you know, for us. And the fact that you had a huge hand in making them and remember so vividly what went into it all. It's so cool. And once again, the YouTube show, No Disintegrations, and you can find that at no disintegrations.tv.
Mark, you also have another, your own YouTube channel, don't you, that features some of your show reels and stuff?
Boba space Fett space capital A-N-H-S-E, A New Hope Special Edition.
Perfect.
And you can see, I found footage of the blue screen shoot from Docking Bay 94, so you should check it out. I found it. It was sped up. It was some footage that someone had shot that must have been on the blue screen stage. He'd sped it up, so I had to stretch it out to normal speed, so it plays a bit jaggedy. But it's much better watching it real time jaggedy than, you know, Benny Hill style.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. I mean, I grew up on Benny Hill. I don't know if Swank knows the reference, but I used to love Benny Hill.
Slapping the head of the old bald guy. Love that.
Yeah. Okay. Swank knows.
Oh, yeah. I love Benny Hill. Oh, man. So good. Now, where else, Mark, if people are interested in hearing your thoughts and knowing more about you, where else can they go online to follow you these days?
I go by the moniker, you know, Boba Fett A-N-H-S-E, and everyone's like, what does A-N-H-S-E stand for? A New Hope Special Edition. But
right,
anything Boba Fett A-N-H-S-E, you can find me.
Awesome. Perfect. Awesome. Well, I hope you had as much fun as we did. I can tell you this was great on this side. Awesome. Wow. Mark Anthony Austin, what a treasure you are, and great stories. And check it out, noticeintegrations.tv. He's also found online at Boba, A-H-S-E, right?
A-N-H-S-E.
A-N-H.
Special edition.
New. I got to get that. Yep. A-N-H-S-E.
Special edition.
There it is. Thank you so much, Mark. Great to chat with you.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you.
Take care.
This is Jeremy Bullock. You're listening to Rebel Force Radio, your source for the Force and also beer.
If you've got the time, we've got the beer.
Boba Beer.
Rebel Force Radio.
The Force is strong with this one.
Your source for the Force.
Wow. Those were some cool stories.
Those were great stories. I mean, that was stuff I thought we were just going to talk to him about Boba Fett. I didn't know we were just going to unleash all of this incredible information about the making of the Star Wars Special Edition. I'm blown away by some of the stories he was telling.
So cool. Very, very
cool. All right,
cool.
Jason, I got to do something here to prepare for our big Zero the Hutt giveaway.
We've got a giveaway. We've been promoting this for some time. This was exclusive for Patreon members, and this was many years ago. Jimmy Mack and I were presented with this incredible Zero the Hutt model. It was hand-sculpted, hand-painted by a Rebel Force Radio listener, and he presented one to each of us. Yes. And it's perfectly in scale with the 3 3/4-inch line of action figures. So if you have Clone Wars action figures from Hasbro, they just go perfectly with this Zero the Hutt. And I mean, it's every bit, I mean, it's not articulated, but it, man, oh man, does it look great on the shelf. And again, if you put it with your action figures, it's fantastic. So anyway, we thought there were only two, like the Sith, only two there were.
Only two.
But apparently the artist has, he crafted another one. He kept one for himself. Then he crafted another and presented it to Jimmy Mack for a giveaway. You know, apparently Rebel Force Radio has meant a lot to him over the years. And he has, wanted to give back to the listener community. And we're facilitating that. So if you're a member of the Patreon group, between when we announced this contest and now, you had an opportunity to go onto the Patreon page and comment on the original post promoting this giveaway. And all you had to do was just comment, I want to party with Zero. And what we have done is we have gathered all of the entries, and everybody got one. It didn't matter how many times you commented, everybody got one entry, except our 1,000th Patreon supporter.
Cannibal Bob.
Cannibal Bob. He got five entries into the contest. Everybody else got one. Cannibal Bob got five for being our 1,000th Patreon supporter. And yes, we are going to draw the winner. Well, we're not. Actually, random.org? Or is it .com? Well, no, random.org.
It's random.org.
Random.org. Okay, I got it up right here.
I've printed up everyone's name who entered on our Patreon page. All of our loyal patrons, we love you guys so much. Your support means the world to the health of this show. And so I printed them all up. We got 260 entries on the page, which I have here, plus an additional five for Cannibal Bob. So that's 265 total entries to win this hand-sculpted, hand-painted Zero the Hutt. And I'm so excited to give this away. There's a picture of it right there. And so we have all these names, numbers assigned to all the names, and Jason is going to use the random number machine.
Yep.
And the way I like to do it, to keep it fair. Mm-hmm. So the way I like to do it is I like to spin the wheel five times. The fifth number we land on will be the winner.
Okay.
And then I will look up the winner's name and the number associated with it. And
five times.
And we'll have a winner. Okay. So go ahead and punch it once.
There you go.
Just here's to make the, here's sure the first punch. Works.
All right. We see the first punch is 158.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Do it again. Number two.
Number two is 52.
Number three.
Number three is 64.
Number four.
Number four is 240.
Okay. So we've mixed it up enough. Now, when I say punch it, the number that appears will be the number of the winner, the corresponds whose name corresponds with the number. So 3, 2, 1, punch it. We have number 118. 118. I'm fishing through all of our entrants.
There's 265 of these.
Could it be Cannibal Bob? Could it be Cannibal Bob? Well, it is not.
It is not Cannibal.
Sorry, Cannibal. Sorry, Cannibal.
Yeah.
It's a guy named Hall Fierce. Hall Fierce. H-A-U-L Fierce. F-I-E-R-C-E. That's our winner. Number 118.
Wow. Winner, winner.
Zero the Hutt for dinner. So, I'm so happy. Thank you, Mr. Zero, for being such a loyal RFR listener. We really enjoyed meeting you at Star Wars Celebration 2017 in Orlando. And for you to reach out to us and offer us your artwork to give away to a luck to Hall Fierce. That's just so giving and wonderful and generous and really what the spirit of Rebel Force Radio and Star Wars is all about.
Chewie, get us out of here.
Freaking out the guitar there. I liked that.
It's not plugged in.
You got to be a member of All Access here on Patreon to get the complete video of the show that you're listening to right now. And wow, I can't say enough about Mark Anthony Austin joining us in the cantina. What a great guy. And just fantastic stories. NoDisintegrations.tv. That's how you can find the YouTube content that he's putting out with the Boba Fett fan club over there. And it's sort of, you know, Boba Fett teaching you the ways of the world. And he is online as Boba A-N-H-S-E online for A New Hope Special Edition. So big thanks to him for hanging out with us. Also, thanks to our friends at Raycon for sponsoring this week's show. Just as a reminder, you can get, as I mentioned, the weekly full show video when you are a member of the All Access tier on Patreon. Patreon is your source for more of the Force, Rebel Force Radio Force, with exclusive podcasts, like we mentioned, RFR Comlink, the Q&A, the Babu Freaks, Clone Wars Declassified Remastered, and so much more. And the only place on the web to get the acclaimed Star Wars Oxygen podcast series. That's the music of John Williams analyzing the soundtracks of the original trilogy, the prequel trilogy, The Force Awakens, and Rogue One. That's all available for you on Patreon. And also, when we're doing our live shows, we take live calls on the live shows. We like to get the Patreon members to the head of the line. So our official call screener, Tyler Page, knows that if you identify yourself as a Patreon member, there's a much better chance that you'll get on the air with us. All those details can be found at patreon.com/Rebel Force Radio. And don't forget our YouTube channel. That is where we do broadcast our live after shows for things like The Mandalorian and currently The Bad Batch. And that can be found at youtube.com/Rebel Force Radio. In addition to those live shows, it's a full repository. It's a virtual archive of RFR content over the last 15 years, classic interviews, parodies, and various bits to the latest live streams, as I mentioned. Also, the new full show audio, they drop on Thursday nights. Jimmy Mack puts these out as premieres. And what that allows RFR listeners to do is all listen to the show as it's premiering at the same time. Occasionally, Jimmy Mack drops in, I drop in, and, you know, there's some people that chat and talk about the episode as it unfolds. And I could just only imagine, I wasn't there for when the Puppet Lando episode dropped from last week, but I can imagine that there was some fun with that. And also, don't forget, with that YouTube, to like and subscribe those videos. We're now over 10,000 subscribers. We are the number one Star Wars podcast on the internet. It's not something we just say. We've got the numbers to prove it, and we would love to be one of the top YouTube channels for Star Wars as well. So please hit that like and the notification bell and subscribe. Costs you nothing. If you'd like to talk to us in between shows, we'd love to hear from you. The email address, show@rebelforceradio.com, or the voicemail line, 708-320-1RFR. That's 708-320-1737. We are on all the social media channels, usual places you might find, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. And
follow us at RFR Rebel Force on Twitter.
Yeah,
there
don't
are
be
Rebel
fooled
Force radio imposters out there. I mean, you know, that's kind of the reason we sort of turned our back on Twitter a while ago. But we've been back on Twitter for a couple years now, and we want you guys to join us there. We're constantly posting up updates, YouTube videos, show updates, merch updates, you name it, Patreon updates. So hit us up on Twitter at RFR Rebel Force for daily RFR updates.
Yeah, and if you get followed by at Rebel Force Radio 1157283, it's not really us, just so you know. I'd hate to burst the bubble, but it's not really us. Yeah, RFR Rebel Force. But above all, we just ask you to keep listening. Keep listening to the show. And one way to do that is to subscribe to the podcast, whether it's your, you know, Apple Podcasts, whatever the podcatcher of choice, follow, subscribe, whatever words they're using. Love to have those subscriptions. Love to have the reviews. They mean a lot to us. Love to have you review the show. Just one rule, please.
Make them good.
And we are streaming 24/7 Apple Podcasts, WGN Plus, Jedi News, iHeart, TuneIn, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Play, anywhere you can find podcasts. You'll find us right here at Rebel Force Radio. And you will find us right here later this week with the Bad Batch After Show, looking at episode 15, the penultimate episode of season one. So I'll be excited to watch the episode and discuss it with Jimmy Mack and all of you. And we'll be back with Rebel Force Radio proper next week, of course. That'll do it for us. We will see you next time for Rebel Force Radio. I'm Jason.
I'm Jimmy Mack.
And remember,
the Force will be with you always.
You're going to see me kill this baby.